بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب، اللهم صل على محمد. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما. The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. The third with your loudest voices in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. Respected brothers and sisters, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Did Imam al-Hussein commit suicide on the 10th of Muharram? Is a central issue of discussion in Islamic history, as well as within Islamic theology, and a central issue of discussion recently in many Muslim communities. For indeed, recently there was a statement that was made that Imam al-Hussein had committed suicide on the 10th of Muharram. This statement was a statement which caused shockwaves in certain Islamic communities, and indeed caused outrage in others, in that many people could not believe that a person could reach a conclusion that the grandson of the Holy Prophet committed suicide on the 10th of Muharram. What was even more ironic was that every non-Muslim in history who has studied what happened on the 10th of Muharram has never once accused Imam al-Hussein of having ever committed suicide, as in if you were to look at the likes of Gandhi or the likes of Charles Dickens, you'll never find them ever coming to the conclusion that Imam al-Hussein walked towards his death on the 10th of Muharram. Rather, you find them coming forward and saying, "I learned how to achieve victory while oppressed through Imam al-Hussein." Or you hear them saying that if Imam al-Hussein was doing the act for worldly desires, then why does he take his woman and his children with him? You find therefore that for someone to say Imam al-Hussein committed suicide is indeed somewhat surprising. But the issue at hand is one which allows us to explore a number of key areas in Islamic theology and indeed within Islamic history, because many times when we hear of the ways the Imams of Ahlul Bayt passed away, many people always ask the question that did they walk towards their deaths? As in, for example, on the night of the 19th, when Imam goes towards Masjid al-Kufa, when Imam sees Ibn Muljam sleeping on the ground, many come forward and ask the question that did Imam walk towards his death when he died on the 19th of Ramadan or when he was struck? Others come and say that Imam, second Imam, when he drank the honey which was full of poison, he knew that this would be something which is going to kill him. Did he walk towards his death? Others say, for example, our eighth Imam, when he had the bunch of grapes that he had from Al-Ma'mun, did he walk towards his death? As in, many have come forward in the past and asked what is the rationale behind giving these Imams knowledge of their deaths before their deaths happen. And indeed, this particular issue requires an analysis from a number of angles in order that we are able to understand the philosophy as to whether Imam al-Hussein committed suicide, and indeed what is the rationale behind the other Imams when they approach their deaths. Let's examine this in a number of stages. Number one, how is suicide viewed in the world's religions today? Is suicide viewed negatively or positively? Number two, can a human being be given knowledge of an event before the event happens? And why does the Quran say all of this knowledge of the unseen belongs solely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Number three, what are the attributes according to the Quran that a person must have for God to give them knowledge of an event before it happens? Number four, what is the importance of the concept of 30,000 versus 18,000? Number five, how important was Hur's conversion on the 10th of Muharram in highlighting that Imam al-Hussein was not in a state of suicide on that day? Let's examine this and completely dissect this issue in depth. When we look at the word suicide without a doubt always has negative connotations surrounding it. As in, you don't find any human being who tells another, "Remind me, what day are you committing suicide? I just want to be there." It's very rare for a human being to actually tell another human being that their act of suicide is a praiseworthy act. As in, if you went to many human beings and asked them psychologically, is the person who commits suicide a person who is to be revered? You find that many of them will come forward and say, no way, the person who commits suicide is someone who psychologically is in a state of despair, someone who's faced the world and its trials in a psychological state of what? A psychological state of cowardice, instead of facing the trials of the world. That particular type of person looks at the world and wants to give up. They don't want to face every trial that comes to them and struggle through it. And that's why when you look at any of the world religions today, you don't find that any of them praise suicide in any way. For example, when you look at Hinduism, Hindu theology looks down at the act of suicide. Why? Hindu theology states that when a person commits suicide, there is an unnatural separation between their body and their soul. What do they mean? They mean that we are made up of a body and soul, aren't we? That body and soul which we have, they state that the gods have given us this body and this soul as a trust. This body and this soul is meant to separate from each other naturally. Suicide is an act of unnatural separation between the body and the soul. In which way? In that when a human being comes to hang themselves or a human being slits their wrists, that human being is unnaturally separating their body and their soul. Every body and every soul has a certain period. Once that period finishes, then they will naturally separate from each other. But for there to be a human being who takes their life away in an unnatural manner is looked down upon. And that's why they say there is a negative karma because of suicide. They say that there is a negative energy that emerges because of suicide. They say when a person commits suicide, there is a negative energy that spreads in the community. Because within Hindu spirituality, every act that we perform has an energy that surrounds it. Likewise, if you were to look within Sikh theology, suicide is looked down upon. Why? Because in Sikh theology, what do you find? You find in Sikh theology, they state that God gave us our lives and God is the only one who has the right to take our lives back. They state that when you as a human being decide that this is my time and I want to take my life away, you have not honored the principles of God. God, what has He done? God has given you a responsibility with this body that He's given you. It's not for you to say that it's my turn now to take my life away. No. You have to say that when God has apportioned a certain time, that's when I can take my life away. Likewise, what do you find? You find at the same time within Jewish theology. Jewish theology looks at suicide extremely negatively. And they look at suicide negatively for two reasons. And both the reasons are quite stunning. The first reason Jewish theology looks at suicide negatively is that Jewish theology comes forward and states that suicide, when a person commits it, they are denying the power of supplication between the creation and the creator. What do they mean? They mean that the power of dua is the idea that I, as a human being, if I ask my Lord in any situation which I'm in, that I require certain help, my Lord can change my situation in a split second, isn't it? As in, you find that what is supplication? Supplication is the idea that I may be going through a trial in my life. While I'm going through this trial in my life, I need my Lord's support in this trial. Dua is that connection between the creation and the creator. For a person to commit suicide means that person's denying the power of dua. That's why Imam al-Hasan salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Imam al-Hasan, what does he state? Imam was asked, what's the difference, what's the distance between the heavens and the earth? And he replied, the cry of an oppressed person in dua. That normally people would expect him to give a figure. People would expect him to say a certain amount of kilometers. No, the Imam said the distance between the heavens and the earth is the cry of an oppressed person in dua. When a person is oppressed, they feel their life is all going against them. One dua and Allah can make the difference. And that's why, what does the Quran say? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِي. When my servant asks you about me, tell them that I am near. I will answer the supplication of the supplicant when he supplicates towards me. When the supplicant in Judaism, what do they say? They say that when God gave you the power of supplication, suicide is an indication that that supplication is what? Suicide is an indication that that supplication is one which is not being respected the way it should be. And the Quran even says, Allah tells His Prophet, tell them, if it wasn't for their dua, I wouldn't care for any of them. Without a doubt. If it wasn't for our dua, Allah would not care for any of us. It's our dua that acts as a continuation, as a connection between us and Allah. The second reason Judaism looks down at suicide is what? The second reason is that Judaism says, mankind, you were born in a struggle, leave the world in a struggle as well. When I was born as a human being, I'm gasping for breath, aren't I? When I'm born, I'm gasping for breath. The moment you see that baby cry, when it comes out of the womb of its mother, it's crying, it's gasping for breath. There's an innate search for struggle, an innate search for direction. Likewise, I should leave this world in a state of struggle, not in a state of cowardice. A state of cowardice is when the human being says, I'm not bothered for this struggle. It's better that I just kill myself and I leave the world. It's a state of despair. Judaism comes forward and offers a quite beautiful conclusion about suicide. Mankind, you are born in a state of struggle. Leave the world in a state of struggle. When you're born and we've made you gasp for breath, likewise we want to see you gasping at the end. But many a great man, this world molded them. As the famous Persian mystic states, O world, how apt and essential you are, even though you have not been loyal to any. Many a man you have broken, many a broken man you have rebuilt. Those who attack you say, don't attack me. You shouldn't blame me. Rather use me as a means of perfection. When you look at the world is a means for perfection for mankind. You struggle through this world. Many a man it broke. Many a broken man it built. You have to use it. At the end, if you struggle, you'll find that you may die in a state of struggle where people look down at you, but over 300 million remember you. Therefore, you found Judaism stated this. Likewise, the religion of Islam came forward. What did the religion of Islam say? The Quran clearly condemned any act of suicide. Because many times people ask the question, has the Quran ever said that suicide is wrong? Yes, very clearly. Surah 4, verse 29. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ Inna Allah kana bikum rahima. Do not kill yourselves. Do not commit suicide. For surely Allah will provide you with mercy. The Quran is very clear. Why does the Quran look down at this act of suicide? Because according to the religion of Islam, the greatest sin is polytheism. But after polytheism, it's despair. Someone will say, what do you mean despair? Surely adultery is a great sin. Yes, but not as great as despair. Surely lying is a great sin. Yes, but not as great as despair. Surely stealing is a great sin. Not as great as despair. Someone says, why is despair the second greatest sin in Islam? Because despair is when the human being puts the creator at the same level as the creation. What do we mean? When I despair of Allah's mercy and Allah's power, what I'm really saying to Allah is, even you can't change my situation. Have you sometimes heard Muslims who say this to you? How many times have you heard a Muslim who turns around to you and says, even God can't change my situation? Do you know this one sentence is an act of kufr? This one sentence. It's an act of complete disbelief. Because what are you doing? You're saying that you, with all your qualities, can't change my trial. The Lord who allowed a virgin to give birth, the Lord who took your prophet above the seventh heaven, you think he can't break the laws of cause and effect and change your situation? As in, how many more times does Allah need to show the human being that the laws of cause and effect are in my hands? If I want to change them, I'll change them at any moment. How dare you despair of my mercy? I can break a law of cause and effect at any moment. Never have yes. Yes is the second greatest sin in Islam. And that's why the Prophet has a hadith where he makes it clear. The Prophet makes it clear. What does he say? He says, in the people of the ancients, there was a person who had a wound on his hand. This person with the wound on his hand, the wound grew bigger. Instead of going through a struggle and hoping Allah will change his situation, he decided to slit that wound even more so that he could die quicker. Rasulullah said, that man will never smell the fragrance of Jannah. Never. Because that man, instead of struggling till the end, what did that man do? No struggle whatsoever. That man showed no sense of competitiveness and no bravery at all. Therefore, when people come and say that Imam al-Hussein committed suicide, the first part of the analysis is what? Is that if the Quran says that you can't commit suicide, Abu Abdullah would not go against the verse of the Quran, would he? As in, if Rasulullah says, I leave behind for you the Quran and my Ahlul Bayt, Imam al-Hussein is the embodiment of the Quran, not the contradiction of the Quran. When a person comes and says Imam al-Hussein committed suicide, has that person admitting that Imam al-Hussein contradicts what the Quran is saying? The Quran is saying, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Imam al-Hussein opposes the Quran or is with the Quran. That's on the first level. Then the second question arises, can a human be given knowledge of an event before it happens? What do we mean? We mean certain people come and say, what's this belief that you say Imam al-Hussein knew about Karbala? That's impossible. You say to them, what do you mean it's impossible? They say, the Quran says it's impossible. You say, what do you mean the Quran says it's impossible? They say in the Quran, Allah says very clearly, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُ. He has knowledge of the unseen. None have this knowledge except him. They say here, how dare you say Imam al-Hussein knew about Karbala? Allah says that I'm the only one who has knowledge of the unseen. Then they give you another verse. They say it's not just that verse. Rasulullah himself admits he doesn't have knowledge of the unseen. Surah 7, verse 188. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ. If I had knowledge of the unseen, I would have used it to benefit myself. They come forward and say, what's this belief that you say your imams have knowledge of an event before it happens? Only Allah has knowledge of the unseen? And Rasulullah himself denies. We reply, let's look at the context of these verses. The context of the first one, which says only Allah has knowledge of the unseen, they are right. Only Allah has absolute independent knowledge of the unseen. What do we mean? We mean that every creation's knowledge of the unseen is dependent on whether Allah shares it with them. The ultimate absolute knowledge of the unseen, that's only with Allah. As in, can we say an imam has independent knowledge? No, because then you're putting the creation with the creator. Only Allah has absolute independent knowledge of the unseen. Then someone says, well, Rasulullah says, I don't have knowledge of unseen. What's the context of the verse? The Arabs came to Rasulullah and said to me, Ya Rasulullah, can you tell us about the tomatoes and cucumbers? Are their prices going to go up or are they going to come down in the markets? Rasulullah turned around to them and he said, if I had that type of the knowledge of the unseen, I would have used it to benefit myself. My Lord, when he gives me knowledge of the unseen, doesn't tell me about tomatoes and cucumbers. My Lord tells me about the theology of man, the ethics of man, the law of man. He's not going to write a verse, Muhammad, go and buy lots of oranges because it will benefit your community in 6 months' time. He finds that this verse, what was he saying? He was saying, if I had that type of knowledge, I'd benefit myself. But even I don't have that type. You find the Quran makes it clear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shared certain knowledge of the unseen with some of his creation. For example, on the very normal level, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, in Surah 3, verse 49, Allah shares knowledge of the unseen with Prophet Jesus. Prophet Jesus used to have a gift. What is it? He could walk past the house and he could tell you what's stored in that house and what the people are eating. The Quran says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا تَأْكُلُونَ وَمَا تَدَّخِّرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ. I can tell you what you eat and what you store in your houses. Is this not knowledge of the unseen? As in, when you walk past someone's house, your vision is partial. You can't tell what's in there. Unless Allah inspires you to have knowledge of the unseen. You find Nabi Yusuf in the Quran. Allah gives him knowledge of an event before it happens. When Nabi Yusuf sees that all the stars are doing sujood to him, isn't it? And he sees the sun and the moon. That was knowledge of an event before it happens. Because what will all those be later on? They'll be his brothers and they'll be his father. So you'll find what? You find when Nabi Yusuf was asked, how did you have this knowledge of the event before the event happens? He replies, ذَلِكُمَا مِمَّا عَلَّمَنِي رَبِّي. That's from what my Lord has decided to teach me. You find Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah gave him knowledge of an event before the event happened. When Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, what did he do? When Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam saw in his dream that he had to sacrifice his son. قال يا بني إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك فانظر ماذا ترى. Oh my son, I see in my dream that I have to sacrifice you. So what's your opinion? Nabi Ibrahim was given knowledge of the event of the sacrifice before the event happens. Even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Even the Holy Prophet himself, Surah 30 of the Quran, many of us recite it in the holy month of Ramadan. Surah al-Rum, the Romans had been defeated by the Persians. Rasulullah told them, in a number of years, you're going to defeat the Persians. 9 years, they asked him, how long? He said, in 9 years' time, the Romans will defeat the Persians. Exactly 9 years later, the Romans defeated the Persians. Does anyone deny this is knowledge of the unseen? Isn't it knowledge of an event before the event happens? Someone then says, okay, I can understand. All the prophets of God have knowledge of the unseen. Surah 72 verse 26 says, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَىٰ غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَىٰ مِنْ رَسُولٍ. He has knowledge of the unseen. He does not give this knowledge to anyone except from the Rasul. So then they say, what do you mean your Imam has knowledge? Isa is a prophet. Ibrahim is a prophet. Muhammad is a prophet. Yusuf is a prophet. What are you talking about that an Imam has knowledge? The best verse to prove that it's not only Anbiya who are given ilm al-ghayb, but also a'imma, is Ayat al-Kursi. Ayat al-Kursi is general, not specific to the a'imma, to the Anbiya. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءٍ. And they do not have access to his knowledge except those who he chooses. Did he specifically say Anbiya? No. He said that those who I choose from my creation, they may be given knowledge of an event before the event happens. And I tell you, even Amir al-Mu'mineen, there's a famous example where Imam walks with Kumail one day. They walk past the house of someone who's sitting there reciting the Quran. Kumail says to the Imam, Imam, look at this person, how religious he is. Imam says to him, what do you mean? He says, look at the way he recites the Quran. His voice is so beautiful. Imam says, Kumail, there'll be a day I'll remind you about this man. In the battle of Nahrawan, when the battle finished, Imam brought Kumail. He said, Kumail, come here with me. Look at that man on the ground. Do you recognize him? Kumail said, no, I don't. Who is he? He said, do you remember there was a day we were walking? And when we were walking, you said to me how beautiful that man is who recites the Quran. What's the point of him knowing the Quran without him seeing my position in the Quran? That look at him on the day of Nahrawan, fighting me in this battle. Is that not knowledge of an event before it happens? Even I'll tell you, normal humans, Habib ibn Madahir, Habib and Maytham al-Tammar, they were so close to Ali ibn Abi Talib, Allah decided to give them knowledge of an event before the event happens. Maytham tells Habib, Habib, are you ready one day to sacrifice your life for the grandson of Rasulullah? He said, it would be my honor to sacrifice my life. Habib said to Maytham, Maytham, are you ready to sacrifice your life one day for Amir al-Mu'mineen where you'll die praising him? Maytham said, it'll be my honor to die praising Ali ibn Abi Talib. You find that both of them were told of their death before it happened. The question is, were they told of their exact place they die? Meaning, at what time and by who? No. They'd be told, that Maytham would be told, in Kufa there's a set of trees. So he'd go and water all the trees every day. Does he know which tree he's going to be crucified in? No. Does anyone, for that matter, from the Anbiya or the Imma, know exactly what time they're going to die and who's exactly going to kill them? No. They know that there's going to be a land where they'll die. Imam asks, what's the name of this land? What's the name of this land? What's the name of this land? He knows there's a land, but does he know at exactly 3:31, 15 seconds? That's exactly what I'm... No. That is reserved for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the space where they're going to die is known. Now someone asked the question. Okay, so he has knowledge of the unseen. Why did Allah give it to him and not to us? What attributes must you have for God to give you knowledge of an event? This is a vital part of the analysis. What attribute must you have for God to give you knowledge of an event before the event happens? Nobody explains this better than Khidr to Musa. Why? Nabi Musa thought he had more knowledge than everybody around him. Allah sent Jibreel. He said, Jibreel, go and tell Musa to search for a man with more knowledge than him. Nabi Musa, as soon as he heard this, he thought, what do you mean he's got more knowledge than me? If there's a man like that, I'll go and seek knowledge from him. And it highlights to us, seek knowledge from the cradle to the grave, not knowledge till 18. There are many Muslims in our community today, cradle till 18, cradle till 25, cradle till 30. You tell them, have you read a book recently? Wallah, I said, Ammar, I'm so busy at the moment in my life. It's hard to read. Nabi Musa, Kaleem Allah, spokesman of Allah. Nabi Musa, who the sea opened for, yet you find him saying, I've got to find this man who has more knowledge than me. Do you know what it was meant, why he had to go and see Khidr? Musa's knowledge of Sharia, of law, was greater than anyone. Khidr's knowledge of the secrets of the unseen was greater than Musa. So he had to go to Khidr. He came to Khidr, he said, I've come to gain knowledge from you. Khidr said, you? He said, yes. He said, you don't have the patience to bear the knowledge I have. What don't you have? The patience to hold the knowledge that I have. Condition number one for holding knowledge of an event before the event happens, you need to have the patience to protect and the humility not to abuse. He said to him, you don't have the patience to bear the knowledge that I have. Nabi Musa said, no, I promise. He said to him, no, I'm sorry, you don't have the patience. He said, no, take me with you, I want to learn from you. He said to him, I'll take you with me, but you don't ask a single question about what you're going to see. He said to him, okay, let's go. So they started. Nabi Khidr saw a boat. He came near that boat. He made a hole in the boat. Nabi Musa said to him, what are you doing making a hole in that boat? Who does it belong to? He said, didn't I tell you you don't have the patience to bear the knowledge? He said, oh, I'm sorry. I won't ask another question. Let's continue. He continued. They saw a young boy. Nabi Khidr came and killed him. Nabi Musa looked at him, he said, what are you doing to this innocent young boy? He said, didn't I tell you you don't have the patience to bear the knowledge of what I have? He said to him, I'm sorry, I'll continue with you, I won't ask a question again. He said to him, he started walking, he saw him repairing a wall. Nabi Musa looked at him, but he knew he had to stay quiet. Nabi Khidr looked at him and said, سَأُنَبِّئُكَ بِتَأْوِيلِ مَا لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. I'll now give you the meaning of that knowledge which you didn't have the patience to hold.
He said to him, okay, explain to me, why did you make a hole in the boat?
He said to him, that boat belonged to a family. And that king, when he rides past that boat, if he normally doesn't see a hole in the boat, he'll steal the boat. But I made a hole, which is small enough to be repaired, big enough for the boat not to be taken, so that that boat belongs to that family forever.
He said to him, so why did you kill the young innocent boy?
He said, many times when we take someone from the life of a human being, they attack God and they say, why did God do that to us? What they don't know is that that child was going to be a menace for that family when he grows up. When we take with mercy. And when we give with mercy. But mankind does not see the mercy behind what we take and what we give. Allah will replace that young boy with a daughter who from her line 70 prophets of God will be born for that family. Then he said to him, why did you repair the wall? He said, behind that wall belongs treasure to two orphans. If the king walks past the wall, he'll steal their treasure. I've repaired it so that they can one day have access to that treasure again in their life. He said to him, Musa, come and walk with me to the sea. He walked with him. He said, Musa, look at that seagull. He said, I see it. He said, Musa, look at that seagull as it goes down towards the sea. He said, I see it. He said, Musa, look at that seagull as it enters the sea. He said, I see it. He said, Musa, look at that seagull as it leaves the sea. He said, I see it. He said, Musa, look at the drops of water falling from the beak of the seagull. He said, I see them. He said, Musa, the drops of water in that ocean, the ratio is our ratio of knowledge in compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are certain things you know which I don't. There are certain things I know which you don't. But above everyone with knowledge is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The point was what? The point was that he was telling him, when Allah gives someone knowledge of the unseen of an event, it's because Allah has recognized they have the patience to protect it and the humility not to abuse it. If I knew Ibn Muljam was going to kill me in Masjid al-Kufa, you think I would have told him, don't sleep on your stomach, it's bad for you? I would have picked up that sword and killed him in Muljam, wouldn't I? If I knew I was going to die in Karbala, I would have booked a holiday and I swear gone to the other side of the world. Because someone like me would not be given knowledge of the unseen. I don't have the humility to protect that knowledge. I will abuse that knowledge. But you find an Imam of Ahlul Bayt has the humility not to abuse that knowledge which Allah has given them. Therefore you find when you come to Imam al-Hussein, why did Allah tell him about Karbala before it happened? On the first level, he had the patience to protect such heavy knowledge. On the second level, he had the humility not to abuse such knowledge. On the third level, something vital has to be understood. The stages of Imam al-Hussein which prove he never committed suicide. What do I mean? Imam al-Hussein at the beginning, he tried to avoid fighting, didn't he? At the beginning, he tried to avoid a fight. When he was in Medina, he didn't want to fight. They chased him out of Medina. He went to Mecca. He didn't want to fight. They chased him out of Mecca. He couldn't perform Hajj. So many people were telling him, Hussein, don't fight, don't fight. Hani told him, don't fight. His brother Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya said to him, my brother Abu Abdullah, go to Yemen. The people of Yemen were the Ansar of your grandfather. They are warm-hearted people. Or at least go and live in the mountains. Go and live in the mountains and see what happens to Yazid. He turned around to me and said, oh my brother Muhammad, wallah, if I was under a rock, they'll still extract me from a rock. Their intention is that wherever I am, they want to kill me. So isn't it better that I stand against them rather than run away from them? If I'm in Medina, they want to kill me. If I'm in Mecca, they want to kill me. If I go to Yemen, they still want to kill me. At first, he wanted to avoid. Then he made the decision, no, I'm going to fight. And you know why he said it? His grandmother Salama said to him, oh Hussein, don't leave Medina. He said to her, why? She said, you'll leave deep sadness in our hearts. He said, my grandmother, they'll kill me wherever I am. So isn't it better that a man like me stands against a man like him? Then he said his famous line, a man like me does not pledge allegiance to a man like him.
I don't care what everyone else is doing. Some were being paid off, isn't it? Some were being bribed. Others ran away. He said, a man like me will never pledge allegiance to a man like him. If it means I'm the last man standing, then through my death, man will achieve freedom. Because they'll see how important it is to stand against injustice. Do you know why people think Karbala was a suicide? Because of the numbers. If now you ask someone, what was the ratio of numbers in Karbala? Do you know what they say? 30,000 versus 72, isn't it? So it makes someone think he walked to his death. At the beginning, it was meant to be 30,000 versus 18,000. Now tell me, does that sound suicidal? If you've got Abbas and Ali al-Akbar next to you, you've got Zuhair ibn al-Qayn and Habib ibn Madahir, 18,000 of you against 30,000, you think you can have them, can't you? Because it's one against two even, isn't it? In Karbala on the 10th of Muharram, every one-on-one battle, Umar bin Sa'ad couldn't defeat Imam al-Husayn's soldiers. He had to double up on them to kill them. Imam al-Husayn, when he left for Karbala, he thought it's a battle 30,000 against 18,000, isn't it? If I told you it was 18,000 against 30,000, would you call it suicide? No, you'll say, I think he can win. But on his way, as the numbers start going down, and some of the people of Kufa don't join him, just because they lost their principles doesn't mean I'll lose mine. They may have lost their principles, but I'll never lose mine. I set out from the beginning to fight against injustice. A man like me never pledges allegiance to a man like him. I thought 18,000 would join me. 18,000 against 30,000, they're in for a chance of winning, aren't they? Just because they don't turn up, does that mean I change my principles? Never. I want to protect the sunnah of my grandfather and the religion of Islam. I'll make sure that through my death, the religion of Islam remains alive. Don't you guys remember a film one day where a person was dying and he shouted freedom? Do you see the paradox? You die, but you shout freedom. Because in your death, others will become alive. In your death, the greatest of principles remain alive. And that's why, do you know what's so interesting? A person who commits suicide, normally his eyes show he's in a state of despair, isn't it? Do you think if his eyes were in a state of despair, Hur bin Yazid al-Riyah, he would have converted on the 10th of Muharram? You know, soldiers, they look at each other's eyes, isn't it? They used to say, Ali ibn Abi Talib in the battlefield needs to only look at your eyes, he's already won the battle. Because when he looks through your eyes, he knows he's going to win. He knows that you know that you're going to lose. And he knows that you know that feeling. So he's going to annihilate you. You think if Hur saw Hussein's eyes, if Hur saw Hussein's eyes were in a state of suicidal despair, do you think Hur would have come across? Have you ever heard of a battle? 30,000 versus 72. None of the 72 joined the 30,000. Some of the 30,000 joined the 72. There's 30,000 of us on one side, there's 72 on the other. What makes you leave? Unless you see that the man opposite you is so confident of his stand that as a soldier you want to die next to that man, isn't it? You look around you and you see all the ones around you are dead men walking. But you see him and you see a man full of principles. A man full of honor. A man full of integrity. You know what Mutahhari says? Mutahhari says when Hussein was lying on the ground, you know how many arrows were on his body? That one hadith says Imam looked like a hedgehog. A hedgehog is full of spikes on his body, isn't it? Hadith says Imam looked like a hedgehog. Do you know what Mutahhari says? He says, whenever a soldier would come to his body, whenever a soldier would come, he'd look, and you know, it took many of them, it took a long time to behead him. Because whenever they'd come, Mutahhari would say, they would look at the arrows, they wouldn't see arrows, they'd see attributes of great humans. One arrow was forbearance, another was honor, another was patience, another was humility, another was integrity. They would look at those arrows, they see a man who was truly alive. On top of that, can you imagine you've come to behead a man, you're sure that he's dead. When you come near him, you think you're sure he's in a state of despair. As you come near his head, you hear him saying, oh Allah, what did I lose when I found you? What did I find when I lost you? If they cut this body into 1,000 pieces, every piece calls out its love for you. Is that despair? That's a man who knows that he's one. And that's why Mutahhari mentions a stunning line. He goes, it wasn't one man against 30,000. It was 30,000 against one. Psychologically, do you know what the difference is? One against 30,000 is you're finished. 30,000 against one psychologically kills you. It takes 30,000 of us against this one man. Tell me, what man won? Was it Yazid or Hussein that Yazid has to send that many to kill Hussein? And Aba Abdullah stands in front of him and knows that he has won simply by the soldiers looking through his eyes. Do you know there was a companion who highlighted Imam was not in a state of despair or suicide on that day. A companion of the Imam, his whole life he was frowning. He was not just frowning, he just frowns at people the whole of his life. On the 10th of Muharram, the companions saw him. They saw him smiling a smile he had never smiled before. They said to him, oh man, all your life you frowned at people. Today I see you smiling. It's the 10th of Muharram. He replied, all my life has been a struggle. But the struggle is now complete with Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Now the struggle is complete. Now I know that I've achieved the victory that I want. For someone to say Imam Hussein committed suicide, it can't be suicide when a man like Hur changes side to join Aba Abdullah. Because what did Hur see in Aba Abdullah? He saw a man full of life, full of vigor, a man full of passion and bravery and dedication to look after the message of his grandfather Rasulullah. And that's why, imagine how difficult it was to lose such a man. If that man is your companion, you find it hard to lose that man. So you're willing to give everything away. Imagine that man is your father. How difficult is it to be separated from him, isn't it? As in, if that man is your father, he stood against all those soldiers. He gave every drop for the religion. A man of warmth like Aba Abdullah, and a man of generosity. Imagine how difficult it is if you're his daughter and you don't see your father come back to you again. And that's why for Ruqayya, the 4-year-old, it was extremely difficult to be without her father. As in, those of you who've been to Sham would have seen that grave of that 4-year-old daughter of Aba Abdullah. That 4-year-old who had missed her father from the moment the horse went out on the 10th of Muharram. I tell you, brothers and sisters, this Ruqayya, people underestimate her value, underestimate how close she was to her father. Do you know this Ruqayya, it wasn't just Aba Abdullah who was a separation from her. She was the one who Abu Fadl al-Abbas heard her say, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. The thirst is killing us, the thirst is killing us. She is the one who said, my uncle Abbas, bring us some water please. She's the one who, after Abbas didn't return, she asked, where is my uncle? They wouldn't tell her because she's a 4-year-old. Do you know what she said? She said, I'm never going to ask for water again. Because if water means my uncle isn't going to come back to me, then it's better that I don't ask for water again. This same Ruqayya, would you believe, when they went to Kufa, what do the narrations say to us? They state that when they went to Kufa, the narration state to us that this same Ruqayya, when they went to Kufa, whenever she would hear a baby, she would hear a baby crying. Do you know what she would turn around? Is that my 6-month-old baby brother? She would say, where is Ali al-Asghar? He was with us, but I don't see him now. But again, the ladies would tell her that your brother is on a journey. She would wonder, where is the 6-month-old baby? And that's why when they took this 4-year-old daughter of Imam al-Hussein, they took her to the ruins of Yazid and Sham, she would be sitting with Rabab, with Layla, with Ramla, she'd be sitting with her auntie Zainab, with Kulthum. Whenever they'd bring out a prayer mat to pray, do you know what she'd say? She'd say, where is my father who used to stay on the prayer mat? I miss my father. I wish my father was next to me. They would keep replying to her, your father is on a long journey. He will return very soon. The narration states that that night she was going to sleep. In her sleep, she saw Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. And she saw him and she woke up from her dream. And she called out, I want to see my father Aba Abdullah.
Abdullah. I wanted to see him next to me now. As soon as she woke up, Auntie Zainab came to her. She said to her, I just saw my father, Abu Abdullah, in my dream. And he said to me that Ruqayya, come back to me tonight. I want to see you. The narration stated that the daughters of Rasulullah began to cry one after another. And they all started crying and crying. The crying and the tears meant Yazid woke up. When Yazid woke up, Yazid called out, what is this crying? What is this sound? And they said to him, it's the four-year-old daughter of Imam al-Hussein. She wants to see the head of her father. Yazid said, very well, then take the head of her father to her. Yazid ordered that they took the head. What did they do? They placed the head in a dish. They placed the head in a pan. They brought the head to Ruqayya. Ruqayya was sitting down. She looked at them. She said to them, oh men, I am not hungry. My auntie, I'm not hungry. I don't want any food. They said to her, it's not food. She removed the top of the dish and she saw the holy head of Imam al-Hussein in front of her. She called out, oh my father, who severed your head from your body. Oh my father, who dyed your beard with your blood. Oh my father, who was there for the orphans after you die. Oh my father, if you saw how they held us as captives. Imam Zain al-Abidin came to her. She was holding on to the head of her father. Imam Zain al-Abidin turned around to say to Zainab, he said, I'm sorry, but she's passed away. She passed away on the head of her father. The narration states that Imam Zain al-Abidin wanted Ruqayya's ghusl to be done. Normally a ghusl is done by a lady for another lady. So that lady took Ruqayya's body. When she took the body, she was about to perform the ghusl. The narration stated that she came back to Sayyida Zainab. She said to her, Sayyida Zainab, there's a problem. She said to her, what is it? She said, I can't wash this girl's body. She said to her, why? She said, because this girl was ill when she died. Sayyida Zainab, she said, she wasn't ill. She was normal. She said, no, she was ill. She said to her, why? She said, I see blue marks on her body and I don't know what they are. Sayyida Zainab looked at her and said to her, those marks aren't the marks of an illness. They are the marks of the whips of Shimr bin Al-Jawshan after Karbala. They are the marks of the soldiers that whipped the body of Ruqayya. إِنَّا لِلَّهُ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Raise your hands, brothers and sisters. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise us with Muhammad and Al Muhammad, to allow us to be amongst the companions of Imam Sahib al-Asr wa-Zaman. Raise us with the Imam of our time. Allow us to receive their intercession in this world and the hereafter. Allow us to be amongst those who defend the message of Imam al-Hussein in this world and the hereafter. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all our brothers around the Islamic world. Inshallah, tomorrow is the night of the Arba'een of Imam al-Hussein. We pray to Allah to allow us to receive his intercession and to be in Karbala this time next year. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Surah al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest of your salawat.